to do a, if I may, I want to do a mini series, and I'm going to do a little teaching on the believer's authority, Now, in this series is designed to take you to that next level of faith. The Bible says we go from faith to faith, from what to what? Faith to faith. And so some of you have not moved from where you first came into the kingdom. Your faith is still salvation faith. And we've got to move from salvation faith into immeasurable grace in faith. There are levels that we ought to ascribe to when we're walking by faith. Because remember, the believer's walk is by faith and not by sight. Is that not right? Doesn't 2 Corinthians teach us that we walk by faith and not by sight? How do we walk?
By faith.
And not by what? And so just like you grow physically, you're not always, you haven't always been a baby. You were there as an infant, then you went through the various stages to get you where you are. And even as adults, I should get some amens after I make this statement. Even as adults, we go through stages. And so my challenge to you is this. Since we go through those stages, why do we stop when it comes to faith? Why do we become complacent when it comes to faith? Some of us are still asking God for stuff already been provided. Some of us are still looking for stuff that's already been provided. Are you hearing me? And so we've got to move beyond just asking for stuff. We've got to move beyond that. We've got to move into a whole different level of faith, into a whole different measure of faith that makes things happen because we declare it and speak it to be so. Are you hearing me? I really want you to hear me. Even our prayers, some of our prayers are too elementary. I mean, how long are you going to be in elementary school? Paul said when you were supposed to be teaching, you're still being taught. What year are you going to grow up? What year are you going to affect society with faith? What year are you going to begin to demonstrate, to be able to exemplify the demonstratives of the power of God and the kingdom of God? So I tell you that it's high time. The world's waiting on us. The world needs us. There's no other answer. While we were in South Africa, and I was challenged by several about the presidential elections, and there were those that were saying, I hope that America's not going to vote for Mr. Trump. Then there were others that were saying, you think Hillary Clinton is going to make it? And I want to tell you something. In our nation, neither one of them are the solution to our problem. We can put the next president, and it's an inevitable that we're going to put somebody in office. I'm not political, so don't even try to go there with me. It's inevitable that we're going to do that. It's either going to be a Republican or a Democrat. You know what I'm saying? Independent is a long shot. But that's an inevitable. But that's not the solution to our problem. They may come in with a creative way to try to cut some of our debt, to add some no programs, cut some programs, add some taxes, take away some taxes, send us to another country to do some fighting, stop some fighting, add money, go monitor North Korea with the nukes, and yeah, may change the gas prices, but that's not the solution to our problem. There's only one entity that exists that has a solution to our problem. That's the church. Because the church represents the kingdom. The church represents the kingdom. Come on, let's say that. The church represents the kingdom. Come on, say it with authority.
The church
represents the kingdom. And the only way this is going to happen is you've got to get kingdom-minded people and get the synergy amongst kingdom-minded people to affect change in society. Okay, all right. This is my intro. It's my intro. So we've got to get beyond where we have been with this faith. It ain't working. You know, it's hard to be in middle school still trying to feed off of elementary. Okay. Yeah, and some of us are beyond that. So look at your neighbor and say to your neighbor, neighbor, it's time to get out of that stuff. So let's talk a little bit about, or let me talk a little bit, and you discuss it with me by your amens, oohs and ahs and ouches and that kind of stuff. Y'all know it's been a while. So yeah, this is an official sermon. Last Sunday, I was honored to team teach with my wife, and so this Sunday I'm doing solo, and I'm going to be in the key of E. Not E flat, but the key of E. Effective. Are you with me? So let's go right into it. So Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1. And let's pick up the narrative around verse 26. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, over the cattle, over all the earth, over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. There's something that I want you to see initially in verse 26. God says, he's talking to somebody because he uses us. That's not singular. So he's talking to, and there are those that are of the persuasion God was talking to himself. God was not talking to himself. He wasn't talking in the second and third person. He was talking to another person. And there's enough scripture to validate that he was talking to his son Jesus, who had not been named yet. David talks about that in the book of Psalms, and he talks about it, and he says, and my Lord said unto my Lord, sit down, you've not been named yet. So before eternity, Jesus had not been named, because we read of nothing in history that brings Jesus on until we get to the new covenant. Right? So he's talking to Jesus. And he says, let us make man in our own image and after our own likeness. Two things that you need to understand here. When you talk about image and likeness, you're talking about form and character. Form and character. Image, form. The best I can describe for you would be the bodily form. As spirit beings, the bodily form and the spirit form are slightly different. I haven't gone to glory to be able to tell you what the spirit being looks like. But it has to look something like the body, because when Jesus was resurrected, they knew who he was. Okay, anyway. So therefore, he said, let's make man. I don't know where this is coming from, but anyway, maybe it's me in the back. Okay, that's the... All right. Commercial, y'all. Commercial. Okay. Let's make man in our own image after our likeness, and let them have dominion. There we go. I think I got that. You notice there in the verse, I put in parentheses reign, because I extracted that from another translation. One translation says, let us have dominion over. Another translation says, let them reign over. Dominion, reign, six in one hand, half a dozen in the other. They both merely mean the same thing. In other words, we're going to make man spirit beings, because God is spirit. What is God? God is spirit. We're going to make man as we are spirit beings, and we're going to put into man our character. We're going to put into man our character. You want to know a little bit about the character of God? Look at the fruits of the Spirit, because the fruits of the Spirit denote the characteristics of God. So when God created man, man already had the fruits of the Spirit. You don't have to pray for the fruits of the Spirit. You don't have to fast for the fruits of the Spirit. You don't have to petition God for the fruits of the Spirit. The fruit is already in you. It just has to be developed. It has to be developed. For example, when a baby is born, walking is already in a baby. It just has to be developed. If you don't believe me, ask some of these women who have been pregnant and been with child before, and they carried that baby, and they say, oh, I felt the baby kick. Oh, come on now. That wasn't no revelation. What if you felt the baby kick? That tells you that walking is automatically in a child, but it's got to be developed. That's why sometimes you can put a child down and after so many months, and you put that child down, and that child will attempt to walk even without you having to teach it how to walk. Y'all not saying nothing. It's innate. So the fruits of the Spirit are already in you, because when God created man, he put into him his character. So in us is already the character of God. It has to be developed. Okay, this is going to be a good series. I can tell you that right now. Because got some of y'all thinking, let's see, Pastor, where can I find that in Scripture? Look it up. So he gives him the form. You are a spirit being. Come on, confess. I am a spirit being.
I am a spirit being.
Possess. You're possessed with what? The character of God. I'm a spirit being with the character of God. That was what God gave us in beginnings. Then he says, let them have rule. Let them have dominion. Let them reign over the fish of the sea, the fowls of the air, over the cattle, and watch this, over all the earth. Over all the earth. That's the point I want you to get right now. Over all the earth. God makes man spirit being, puts his character in him, and then gives him authority over all the earth. Over all the earth. Let's say it. Over all the earth. Say it again. Come on. Over all the earth. Verse 27. So God did what he said, let's do. That's what verse 27 says. He created them godlike. Remember, my verses are a compilation of about 6 or 7 translations. He created human beings who are spirit beings that has a human body. He created them what like? God-like, reflecting whose nature? Reflecting God's nature. There he created both male and female. So man ain't the only one with God's nature. Woman is as well. Oh, y'all quiet now. Yes. She's in it too. Look at verse 28. Then God blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and govern it. Fill the earth and govern it. Fill the earth and govern it. He's already given them authority. He's already given that to them. He now gives them a clear directive. Be fruitful, multiply. A little different from what he has said, let's do in verse 26. A little different from what he said in verse 27 that he did. He now adds something else to this. Be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and govern it. Govern it. You're the authority. Govern the earth. Govern the earth. Reign over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, all the animals that scurry along the ground. So let's look at this and see. God creates man. He empowers man. He deputizes man. He gives him total, watch this, unconditional authority over all the earth realm. Total, unconditional authority. Adonis, unconditional authority. Unconditional authority. Come on, let that kind of soak in a moment. Complete, unconditional authority over all the earth. Now, Pastor, don't it just say the animals? Read the whole thing. Over all the earth, anything that is and anything that will be comes under man's auspices, because he has been given unconditional authority, Linda. God's given it to man. That's some wild stuff right there. Some wild stuff. Next, I want you to see this. He then, after he creates, empowers, and deputizes him, gives him total unconditional authority over all the earth, he equips man to reproduce himself through himself in his offspring. In other words, he now says, Taj, I want you to reproduce me by bringing forth sons and daughters. Bring forth children. Reproduce me through you. So God reproduces himself through man in children, so that generations and generations and generations and generations that are coming up has the same A word. What's the A word? They have the same what? Everybody coming out of Adam and Eve has the same what? Because it's unconditional. Didn't say if they save or not. Didn't say if they go to church or not. Y'all won't talk to me. It didn't say that they have to be a member of any church. He gave everybody unconditional authority. Do you see what I see? Then says, recreate me through you in them so that they come forth, spirit beings, with my character, with unconditional authority, ruling, reigning, governing over all the earth. Teach them how to rule, reign, and govern over all the earth. Not teach them how to get high. Not teach them how to be brawlers. Not teach them how to cuss. Come on, don't get quiet now. Not teach them, don't teach them how to go jump from one job to another job. Don't teach them how to be church hoppers. I don't like this, so let me go somewhere else. Don't teach them how to be envious. Don't teach them how to be judgmental and disgruntled, frustrated. Don't teach them how to be prejudiced. Teach them my character. And then teach them how to rule with balance. You see, Keith, if I teach them God's character, I teach them balance. I teach them how to be able to exist and live and thrive in the earth that we live in. Watch now. I teach them how to live and thrive in the earth that we live in authoritatively. Authoritatively. Not trying, Mama T, to run people and trying to be authority over people. You've got the whole earth. Because you can't make people do what they don't want to do. You can tame an animal, but it's hard to tame a man or a woman. Okay. All right. So then watch this now. He provides a location. And that location is called the Garden of Eden. And the word Eden means delight. The word Eden means what? So he provides for them a delightful location, a habitation, and an environment fully facilitated for his enjoyment and dominion. So man gets a place called delight, a habitation. He lives there. The environment has everything he could ever imagine. Beyond his imagination, he has all of that. Watch this. For man's enjoyment and for man's dominion. So that way, man don't start getting all frustrated and carrying on and acting up because things just ain't happening the way I want. He put everything there. Can I tell you something? Here's a news flash for you. Even today, everything is still here that we need. Y'all had one or two amens. Everything is still here that we need. God ain't having to make nothing. We're going to Mars to be curious. We're going to the moon to be curious, not to try to bring something back here. Because everything we need, he already facilitated right here in the earth. He didn't say the other parts. He didn't say anything about the other nine different planets. He talked about the earth. Everybody say the earth. Now, please, this is not Pastor trying to throw off and say that we shouldn't be going. Nah, I'm not, don't try to put words in my mouth. I don't mind them going to space. Just don't ask me to go. I don't mind them going to Mars, going to Jupiter, getting out, walking on it. They can go, get out, walk. You know, that's not my lane. I'll bypass that when I go to heaven. I'll get there a lot faster than they will. Quicker than right now, sooner than at once. I'll be up there. Or you could blink an eye, we'd be up there. Come on, y'all. So, you know, I'm not anxious to go. I'm just trying to rule and reign right here on the earth, okay? You still here? Let me show you one more thing here. He forbids them, with all of this that God has done, created them in his own image after his own likeness, gives them authority, unconditional authority, gives them a place called delight, a habitation, and an environment fully equipped for his enjoyment and dominion. Then he does this to finish it off. He says, now, all of this I've given you, there's just one tree, not a garden, not a grove. One tree. Everybody say one tree. There's only one tree that you shouldn't eat from, and that is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now, I know when we watch television, you know, sometimes on TV, we look at stories about Adam and Eve and Keith. There's this tree that seems to look more appealing than all trees. Sometimes producers will make the tree flaming or make something different about the tree, you know, so that you can kind of get an idea. You know, when you're watching television and looking at movies, they've got to really be creative to captivate your attention. And sometimes they straight up lie. No amens? Well, Pastor, they're just trying to just be lying. Because what happens with it is you already got people with bad doctrine anyway. Then they go watch television and they'll, you know, like this last Noah movie that they did. Oh, Lord have mercy. I want to beat them people up. It's like, come on, Noah, was that thrown? You know, and there are people that'll go and walk away from that movie. They don't know nothing about the Bible. And they'll say, that was really what the Bible was. See that? Okay, y'all, I think y'all coming around now. So, look. There was nothing different about Willie Mack. There was nothing different about this tree from any other tree. You see, for God to mark the tree would have automatically appealed to the eye. So what he does is he puts the tree there and can I tell y'all something? All of the trees had the propensity to be the tree of knowledge of good and evil. But it was just one. So that way, listen, Lenore, that way, no matter how much man wanted to eat, God said, I got this. All the fruit everywhere is just one tree. Well, Pastor, how you know what the tree is? I don't know what the tree is. I wouldn't want to know. It's too late. But he said, don't touch that tree. Because that tree is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So therefore, when man was created, man only had knowledge of one thing. Good. So man was created innocent, not perfect. Come on, you need to put that in your notes. We were not created perfect. We were created innocent. Some people say ignorant, meaning lack knowledge. And it was a knowledge, watch, it was a knowledge that God did not want us to have. But he never took that away from us, the right to make our own decision. Are you still here? I've given you authority over all the earth and everything that you need. Stay focused on that. How many times in our lives have we got sidetracked with things that have nothing to do with our vision, things that have nothing to do with our destiny, things that have nothing to do with our lane? And we become consumed with it. We're trying to bring evil over into good. Okay, I don't want to do that. And then let's look. Let me show you something. Who is God to do all of this? Let's see how God can give us this kind of authority. In Jeremiah 27 and 5, watch what he says. With my great strength and powerful arm, I made the earth and all its people and every animal. And I can give these things of mine to anybody I choose. Y'all better see this now. Is that some good trash talking right there or what? I made all of this. And I can give it away to whoever I choose, whenever I choose, however I choose. So God could actually say this and do it. Look at Psalms 115 and 16. For all you people that want to get on the rapture bus stop, please see this. The heavens belong to the Lord. But the earth he has given to man. Where you going? Come on, where you going? I just want to go to heaven. For what? It's only a vacation site. But I want to get to the vacation side. But you ain't done nothing. Usually people take a vacation because they have worked for prolonged periods, and now in they have now set time aside where they can take a break from work. But who ever heard of staying on a lifetime vacation? Am I making sense? You know, there are a lot of people in the body of Christ, they just ready to go to heaven. Ain't done nothing. Wednesday night, and I really was wishing for more of you to have been to Wednesday night and Wednesday in the Word at 7. Elder Chris was teaching and talking about the various thrones and the various crowns. It's an outstanding lesson. Outstanding, outstanding. And there are a lot of folks trying to get a crown that you ain't done nothing. There are several different crowns that are mentioned in the Bible, and some of y'all are going to be up there without a crown. Then some of y'all ain't going to get to go up there anyway. I'm not talking about you in here. I mean, there are people that are streaming with us. I pray I ain't talking about you. Yeah, some people, the Word of God said a liar won't even get to tarry in his sight. You know, they'll be judging you long distance. You on the cuffs of hell. God judging you down there because he don't want lying up there. Okay, all right, I'm just telling you what the Bible says. So there are people that are trying to forego and disannul the authority that God has given us here in the earth. They're trying to bypass what God has already prepared for us, and all we got to do is work for the vacation. Okay, so the heavens belong to who? The heavens belong to who? But the earth he's have given to who? So there we go. There we go. So the earth is our domain. When God did what he did, he gives to man, here you have the lease on earth. You have the authority on earth. Nobody exceeds you on earth. And the only way anyone can come in and even refute you, they would have to be of equal to you. Oh, come on now. They would have to be a human that is a spirit being. Are you hearing me now? Otherwise, they don't have the right to refute you, and you have the authority to cut them out. Cut them off. Do y'all hear what I'm saying? Watch this now. Man, and when I say man, remember both man and woman, because the authority was equal opportunity authority. God is a God of equality. He didn't give man authority and then didn't give the woman authority. They got the same authority, just different responsibilities with the authority. You won't talk to me. You got to understand that, and you got to get that real clear, because there are those that are of the persuasion that only the man has the authority and the woman has got to be subject. Yes, the woman does have to be subject, but they have equal authority. What kind of God wants to create a world where the man would be the only one that can cast out a devil and the woman got to wait for him to come home? She liable to have to cast him out first just to cast. Okay, now, amen. Okay, I'm being messy. Let me stop. So everybody say equal authority. Say it again. Equal authority, different responsibilities, but equal authority. That's the way God operates. Now watch this. So man has now been given, watch these three, unrestricted, unconditional, and non-reversal authority over all the earth. Unrestricted, unconditional. Hamad, it's wide open. You don't like something? You have the authority to change it. Something goes awry, you have the authority to bring it back in line. Says who? Says the man that owns the place. Remember, he said, I can do what I want to do. I created it. Are you still here? And so, watch now. He has this unrestricted. Are y'all getting this? I want you to see the impact of who we really are and what we really have in our arsenal. unconditional, non-reversal. That means, Taj, you can go out and screw up, and God does not reverse the authority that he's given you. Even if you didn't want it, God said, I ain't taking it back. You know, you all have heard me say this quite often, where I grew up and they would teach us as young kids that, you know, if you don't use your gift, God will take it from you and give it to somebody else. And I, along with a lot of people that I know, and when I say a lot, I mean a lot. There are a lot of people that grew up in the church, Tamika, that were of the same persuasion. And they ceased to operate in the church in years ahead because they were told that if you didn't use your gift, God will take it from you and give it to somebody else. I was even told that, you know, Pastor Jeff, I was told that and said, you know, you because they asked me to sing a solo and I told them I didn't feel like it. So God's going to just take your voice. He'll give it to somebody else that want to be willing to sing. I rebuke that. I mean, what kind of way is that to encourage me about God being a good God, but he's going to take it from me to give it to somebody else because I didn't want to sing? Everybody say unconditional. Whether Keith uses the authority or not, God said it's still with you. I don't take away the badge. I deputized you. And when I deputized you, it wasn't based on anything but me. Remember in Hebrews it says when God couldn't swear by nobody, he swore by himself because there was nobody greater than him to swear by? That's why he tells you don't you dare swear because you created nothing, so you don't have a right to swear by nothing. Are y'all still in here? And I want you to see the real clear picture. So what he does, Carolyn, is he makes sure that even when you sin, you don't have to back away from the enemy. Well, you know, because I the anointing probably done left my life. Get out of here. I want you to get a point. Having the authority and anointing are two different things. They both start with an A, but they're two different things. See, you can have an authority without having an anointing. But you're highly potent when you have an authority with the anointing. And only we who believe can operate authoritatively under the anointing. People who don't believe, they don't have access to that. That's some precious stuff right there. Do you understand? That's some precious stuff. You have the right to speak into the life of somebody, and it comes to pass because of your authority. Come on. You have the right to do it. And I know that many of us, I can't be the only one. I know many of us are of the persuasion. I've done some speaking and stuff to stuff, and stuff didn't change. See, let me make one thing real clear. I'm not here to try to defend God. You see, Adonis, because there are a lot of people want you to try to defend God and God's actions. God, watch this. What's the vernacular now? God done what he did when he done it in the beginning. He ain't doing nothing else. You got that? Do you understand what I'm saying? You've got to understand that. So I don't need Tracy to try to defend God. Who can know the thoughts of God save the Holy Spirit reveals it to us anyway? And then when he does reveal it to us, the Bible says we can only speak in part or prophesy in the part that we have revelation of or that's been imparted. Are y'all hearing me? Even when it comes to prophecy, Antoine, you can't prophesy at a level where your faith is not. Because your level of faith determines the level of prophecy that you can bring forth. On any ongoing basis. Oh, wow. So you're only going to get a part. So I can't, Carolyn, and I will not try to explain why God did or did not. Because remember, whatever happened that we enjoy now was done before there was a beginning. We're just walking it out. And watch this. Watch this, Hamad, because I want you to understand. a true man of integrity. Since we know already, based on Scripture, that God has rested from his work and has given us the authority, not a, come on, he has given us the authority over all the earth, since we know that already, why do we think that God's going to come into the earth realm and invade our earth with an authority that he's already given us? Then what that means, Taj, is that he don't have confidence in us. Come on, y'all. See, I want you to help you to understand, Linda. We've got to stop trying to get God to come in and do stuff that we have authority over. He don't operate like that. Come on. Can't you tell by now? You haven't been able to tell in all the prayers you done prayed. You know how you've given up hope and stopped praying and all that kind of good stuff. Well, maybe God ain't hearing me. No, God heard you, but he's not going to come in and break his word. I have given you authority over all the earth. You've got to use what I gave you, and if you use what I gave you because of who you are and whose you are, what I created in you, it's got to come to pass. It's got to come to pass. So there we go, Keith. We can no longer. Oh, Lord. Come on in the room right now. Touch everyone right now. Save it. Go in the hospital right now. Heal in the hospital. Save it. If you ain't going, he ain't going. I thought I'd get a better amen than that. Kind of hard to preach to people that won't even say amen to you. Let me go down the street and maybe find me another church where they say amen. Yeah, you're trying to get him to go. He ain't going if you ain't going. Go in the prisons, Lord. Save them prisoners, Lord. He ain't going. You ain't going, he ain't going. Moving our neighborhood, he can't. You ain't moving, he ain't moving. Don't get it twisted. I want you to get the point. I want you to see this. You have been given the authority over all the earth. God ain't coming back in the earth realm to do nothing when he's given it all to you. What does that look like? What does that look like, Hamad? I've given you authority to take charge, to destroy yokes, to put things back together, to restore. I've given you the authority to stop the invasion going on.
Well, if God is such a loving God, why are he letting all these people die with ISIS? He ain't. You are. What were we getting mad at God for because we couldn't find bin Laden? God ought to reveal to somebody. Well, you got a prophet, tell the prophet.
Whoops. Where'd that come from?
I want you to understand, when we talk about authority over all the earth, he doesn't give you something, Keith. He doesn't give you an authority that you can't use, be well equipped to annihilate any and everything that comes up against you. He didn't give you an authority so that when things get big, Sybil, then you have to, Lord, I need you right now. Oh, Lord, you said you wouldn't put no more on me than I can bear. Jesus, the load is heavy. Shut up. So what you want him to do? Come in and lift your load. Lift my burden. What's wrong with you? Soon as you lift it, it's lifted. Oh, and you praying and getting mad at God because he won't invade your circumstance. He can't violate his will. He can't violate what he's already set in motion.
This is some good stuff right here, huh?
Do I have you thinking? I want you to do more than think. I'm getting, you know, y'all remember back in the gap when they used to say, whoop, upside head, go whoop.
Okay, y'all didn't go to school, and I understand. I don't know what y'all cheerleaders was doing. But when we was going to school, they was whooping them upside the head.
You know, we was kicking them and everything else. You know, them cheerleaders was radical. You know, if we go to a game now and the people watching the game don't even watch the cheerleaders. When we went to games, you was watching the cheerleaders. The cheerleaders was doing, you watched them for two reasons, especially if you was a man. You watched them, number one, because they was good looking. Number two, you had to know what was going on, and they would tell you about a song they were singing, about a cheer. Okay, never mind. All right. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you. See, coach know about that stuff. Yes. All right. Let me give you some quick illustrations, because I want you to really understand clearly, Linda, the authority that you have as a believer, that you have, not having to go get, not have to pray, not have to fast. I'm going on a 30-day consecration. Bless you. See you when you get through. You know, the Lord is moving me, to go on a fast so I can abound in his authority. I ain't hating on you. You know, it's one thing to have authority, something else to abound in it. You may need to go die some more to abound. Come on, hello. Okay, all right. I just want to make sure. It's like I have to cover all bases because, you know, people be looking at you and saying all kind of stuff. Okay, now watch this. Look, remember Moses? Let's talk about authority that he's given to us over all the earth. Remember Moses? Let me give you some quick stuff here. What about the bitter water at Meribah and Moses throws into the water? The water turns sweet. What about the 10 plagues where he defied all the animal kingdom's authority, where he defied authority of man and spoke and the plagues came? What about the parting of the Red Sea where he defied gravity, where he defied nature? He spoke through the execution of a rod. That's authority. I'm going to get me a rod. What you going to do with it? You won't even use your hand to lay hands on nobody. You going to get a rod? I'm about to beat you with that rod. Hey, come on now. Do you really understand? See, it's one thing to talk about Jesus, but let's talk about Moses. There was nothing supernatural about him. They didn't even know if there'd be any such thing as the Holy Spirit. Wasn't nobody having them come, you know, we come to service and, you know, and we're going to lay hands on you and we're going to anoint you and you're going to be anointed to go out. And this anointing that's going to be on your life, you're going to be able to break chains and you're going to be able to call things that be not as though they were. You know nothing about that. You got to remember, this man come from a family that worshiped the sun god. Okay, let me leave it alone. So how about Elijah? Remember Elijah declaring there would be no rain in Samaria? And what happened? No rain. He spoke to the elements. Hold your peace. Everybody say authority. Remember the widow at Zarephath? When he was at the brook and he had the ravens bringing him, you know, a snack pack every day, three times a day. He had Kentucky in the morning, Chick-fil-A in the afternoon. Y'all not here? And Panera in the evening. And then had water, the oasis water, every time he got thirsty. Only one problem, the brook dried up, and he started acting like some of us. We keep expecting God to operate the same way all the time, and we never want to elevate our faith, step into the next level of our testing, so that we can come through that test tried and true. Come on, faith validated through the test that I came through, and because of convenience he stayed right there. Keith, hey Lord, what you doing? I ain't seen the raven this morning, and I don't know if you noticed, but the brook didn't dry it up. I'm sure the angel said, look, when the brook dry up, sugar, it's time for you to move. Then he got
And then he got word, Antoine, go to Zarephath. I've already prepared somebody there to take care of you. And so he goes to Zarephath. This is what gets me. I love this story. He goes to Zarephath. And when he goes to Zarephath, Sybil, he finds a woman that's gathering sticks and says to her, now, lady, with these sticks, I want you to go home, make a fire, and cook me a whole cake. And this is where it really gets me. She said, sir, I got enough meal and oil to cook one whole cake for my son and I. Then we're going to die. Why would the Lord send you to somebody broke? I'm telling you, that Carolyn, that bothers me. If you know, for a long time, why I'm out here hungry now, and you send me to somebody that can't even afford to make me a meal? I just asked for a whole cake. That's my appetizer. Or as they say in South Africa, that's my starter. I haven't asked for a meal, just a whole cake. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry, y'all don't know what a whole cake is. Ask some of the saints after it's over. So he sends Elijah to a woman who is incapable of preparing a meal for him. Isn't God amazing? And he has to do that in order for Elijah to understand a new level of authority that God was taking him into. See, the last level of authority was good. It was easy because ravens were bringing it and the water was there. So that didn't require much. But now he's got to move from where it was to where it is. So he goes to a dry place and says, now I want you to go and cook me that whole cake. You and your son won't die. We'll all get to eat. But cook mine. Watch the language. Cook mine first. Now, Pastor, she already told you I got enough to cook one for my son and I. Look what he says. Cook mine first. Go cook, but cook mine first. She just told you it's only enough for one. Come on, y'all. You got to see authority at work right here. He says, cook mine first. I understand what you're telling me about you and your boy. I got that. But cook mine first, then you and your son, you won't die. And the woman, to my amazement, the woman goes and does just what he said. Well, if you want to get what God says you're going to have, you got to do just what, come on, y'all, God said. Yo, this is some good teaching right here, huh? I got to hurry up. So watch now. And the Bible says, one preacher, I used to love him, and the Bible says. So, and the Bible says, watch now. The Bible says that when that woman, Hamad, cooked that one whole cake for the prophet, and he started eating, the Bible says she went down into the barrel, and she never ran out of meal nor oil. She only had enough to cook one. But when she obeyed, because of the authority that the man of God had, under that authority and her obedience, she never ever ran out. Now watch this. They even ask him, can you stick around? You know, you're a good meal ticket. We like you. We eat good when you're around. Watch. The Bible says that after a while, the Zarephath woman's son fell ill. And he died. And he said, bring me the child. She comes in there with the child in her arms. He takes him in his arms, and he goes upstairs with the child. I know some of y'all thinking, no, that's Elisha. No, you just know your stories. Very similar. Similar anointings, similar stories. Watch. Goes upstairs. Does a prophetic stretch. The child is revived. He defied death. Oh, my goodness. And because of that authority, he gave her back her son. Dead son revived. Remember, he calls down fire. Remember Elijah calling down fire? Speaks to the heavens and commands rain to come down like fire. Just the same way at Mount Carmel. Y'all remember the Mount Carmel? I don't have time to go through the story. But the Mount Carmel episode, after them guys had done all that stuff, 400 prophets of Baal, and he did the unthinkable. You usually put water on a fire. He put water on the wood and filled up the trench and then called on God and commanded fire to come down and breaking all of the laws, breaking all the laws that have been in place for gravity and for the earth to operate and all of the various laws of the earth in that respect. And boom, science can't even figure it out. Fire comes, consumes up the altar, consumes up the sacrifice. And then, watch this, I like this. Elijah say, kill them all. Kill them all. They're demons anyway. That's authority. Okay, what about Elijah? Give me a couple more and I'm going to stop. What about Elisha? We talked about Elijah. Can I tell you about Elisha? Remember Naaman, the big time colonel, if I may? The little girl says, the maidservant says, my master have, he have this leprosy and he's come, got all these gifts, and he needs you to come and pray for him. And Elijah, watch this. Well, Elisha doesn't go and pray for him. Elisha says, tell him. Tell him I said. Tell him I said, go dip in Jordan 7 times. Can you imagine Jordan, which was, it was kind of like, Jordan was one of those kind of rivers where you had a couple of other rivers that flowed into it, like a tributary, and it began to compile trash, and it was real nasty and dirty, and germy. Germs were there. It was like a dumping place. And Naaman says, you mean to tell me he want me to go to Jordan and dip me, the colonel? Well, I guess Elijah thinking, well, you ain't going to benefit nobody. You got leprosy, dog. You better go do something. The authority that Elisha had to speak and say, don't matter, go dip. And the Bible says, after he come up that 7th time, Carolyn, he just had a hay baby with straw legs. Ah! Healed. The authority of the man of God had such an impact that it could change the power of just plain water into healing power. You still here? Remember when Elijah and Elijah were walking and they got to the Jordan River and Elijah takes off his cloak and he strikes the water and the waters part so that he and Elijah both can walk through the Jordan with his jacket. He just hits the, come on, y'all. That's authority. Oh, my goodness. One more. Let me give you one more from Elijah. Remember they came to him and said, Elisha, the water is bitter and it's causing sickness. And he said, bring me a bowl of water and some salt. And they brought him a bowl of water and some salt, and he put some salt in the water that was in the bowl. threw it out into the river. And all of a sudden, the bitter water that was making people sick now became sweet. It became drinkable. I'm talking about authority. I was asked the other day, and I'm going to wrap up here. I was asked the other day, Elder Chris, I've been asked about going to make a presentation, the vice president, in Liberia. And so somebody had asked me, said, "You mean to tell me you go to Liberia? What about Ebola?" I said, "Well, what about God?" So I'm going to say, Hamad, I don't want to take a chance going to Liberia. That ain't wisdom, because there's Ebola. Yeah, but there's also money for me and for the kingdom. Y'all didn't hear that. Pastor, that sounds like greed. Well, you need to be saved. You need to be saved. So they're trying to tell me, you know, and am I afraid of going, and am I afraid of Ebola? No. No. Now, I will take some vaccinations or shots or whatever it is that I would do for the sake of my body. But I'm just telling you, I am not fearing Ebola, Yobola, Nobola, any kind of Ebola. Give you Jacob, and then I'm finished. Remember Jacob, he places bark from several different trees, and he peels the bark from almond and two or three other different trees, and he takes this bark and he puts it at the trough where the cattle, the sheep, and the goats would come and drink. It was also a place where they would come and mate. And so what he did was, when he stripped the bark and he put it there in the trough, when they would drink, when they would actually drink and mate, you had plain colored sheep and goats. And when they would mate, from looking at that particular bark, it would produce, watch this, streaked, speckled, and spotted flocks. You got that? He walked in an authority. Laban tricked him, and he got aroused. Wait a minute, I have authority over all deceit. Hey. He was able to turn that thing around. Now, I'm going to stop this morning, because next week I want to come and I want to show you next week that based on scripture. Thank you. Based on scripture, really and truly, the authority that we had initially, we lost it. We lost it. Are you hearing me? We what? Come on. What did we do? We lost it. The whole essence of it was, Satan came in the form of a serpent, since he couldn't come in the form of an individual. And what he did was, he negotiated with Eve so we could lose that authority. And then that left us susceptible, because we gave it away. But I got to show you how we got it back. And I'm telling you right now, everyone in this room, there's an authority that's been given to you. The only reason you're not abounding in it is because you don't want to. You're waiting for something to happen, and it ain't going to happen the way you think it's going to happen. You're waiting on God, but God's been waiting on you. Let's stand up. I said you're waiting on God, but God's been waiting on you. Did you get something out of the lesson this morning? I said, did you get something out of the lesson this morning?